Good morning. The chief guest of this morning function, Captain Ganesh Karnik, member of Legislative Council, Government of Karnataka, dear students and my colleagues. As you know, this is a very important and auspicious day for us. We have been celebrating one of the very important thing, that is AZADI AT 70, YAAD KARO KURBANI. And as a part of the celebration, we have organized this special lecture by Captain Ganesh Karnik, and we are privileged to have him here. He has certainly a lot of other busy schedules, and he has been able to find time for us. So let me, on behalf of the Department of Geopolitics and International Relations, welcome him. Sir, we welcome you here, sir. We are delighted.
Thank you.
And I call upon our class representative of MA first year, Ms. Biswa Khatre, to present a bouquet. As you know, that this is going to be a special address, and the theme which we had chosen was the spirit of India's freedom of struggle. What we thought was that let Captain Ganesh Karnik speak for around 10 to 15 or 20 minutes as per his convenience, and let us get the benefit of his knowledge by asking questions to him. Before I request him to deliver his special address, I request my colleague Dr. Nandikishor to formally introduce him.
Good morning, everybody. In Sanskrit, there is a saying. It says, Sajjanasya hridayam navanitam yadvadanti vibudas tadalikam anyadeha vilasat paripakam sajjano dravati navanitam. It says, the hearts of the nobleman is compared to soft butter by the learned, but the hearts of noblemen is softer than the soft butter. While the butter melts from the nearness of the heart, the hearts of the noblemen melt at the troubles and tribulations suffered by others, even if they are far off. I am using this specific quote from the Sanskrit for the simple reason to, because I'm formally introducing him. Whatever I'm introducing him is something that will not bring out the other side of Captain Ganesh Karnik. I've known him for quite some time. Let's say probably 5 years, though I formally introduced myself and I met him only the previous semester when we shared the dais in a music program where I also had to deliver a lecture. So the specific one is apt to him for the simple reason that anybody who looks up to him or who walks up to him with a problem, he would be the first to listen to them and do whatever that is possible. Now, having said that, let me take this privilege to introduce Captain Ganesh Karnik. He's the member of the Karnataka Legislative Council, Southwest Teachers Constituency. He's also the opposition chief whip, Karnataka Legislative Council. Hails from agriculture family from our own Karkala Taluk in the Udupi district. In the year 1981, he got his degree from University of Agriculture Sciences College of Agriculture, Dharwad. And then he cleared his combined defense service examinations, and he was trained in officers training academy Chennai. Then he joined to the Indian Army as a commissioned officer in the artillery regiment. He has served along with the northern, eastern and western borders of the country. He took voluntary release from the Indian Army as a captain in November 1988. Then he also served as the AGM of Lemania Suspension Products Limited, one of the prestigious companies, industrial groups in coastal Karnataka, till 1992. He has been serving at several positions. As I told you, he's the chief whip of the opposition party. He's also a member of the Legislative Council. He's a national co-convener of the BJP's teacher cell, member of the Academic Council of MIT School of Government, Pune. He's also president of the Manikrishna Swami Academy, Mangalore. He's also the president of the Swadeshi Vignan Andolan, Karnataka. Apart from this, there are several accolades that are there with him. He's also the deputy chairman of the NRI Forum of the Karnataka state with the cabinet status that was there from 2008 to 2012. He's part of several other committees such as Mangalore University Senate Syndicate and the Finance Committee, Academic Council of Karnataka University, Law University, Mangalore University, and he's also part of the Public Relations Society of India, Mangalore and Manipal chapter. He's also member of the Committee on Women and Child Welfare, Public Accounts Committee, petitions committee, and he is also state organizing secretary of Karnataka State Secondary Teachers Association. Apart from that, he has traveled extensively in Europe and other parts of the world, that includes US, UK, Germany, China, Singapore, Japan, and all this. His area of interest includes strategic and several other components that we talk about. He is interested in music. He also looks at the agriculture and rural economy, welfare of the ex-servicemen. Sir, indeed, it's a privilege to have you this morning here, sir. So I welcome you to address the gathering. Thank you.
Good morning to everybody. Professor Nandkishore, thank you for this wonderful introduction. In fact, when somebody introduces you, you get motivated to do more. So thank you very much for that. Is it the mic? You're trying to. If you can help me, there are two controls, you know, treble and this thing. If you can bring down the bass sound, I'll be grateful. Thank you. Professor Arvind Kumar and Professor Nandkishore and my young friends, let me offer my greetings and best wishes on the 70th anniversary of our independence. I hope everyone understands. In between, if I switch over to Kannada, there may not be anyone here. Kannada, you don't understand? Okay, some of you at least. There are two components to this talk they mentioned. One is Azadi at 70, and other one is the freedom struggle. I think I'll focus more on Azadi at 70 than on the freedom struggle, because freedom struggle is a historical aspect. All of us can access information through internet and find out who are all involved, how many of them sacrificed, how it developed, and you know, from 1857, supposedly the first freedom struggle of a country, as per the history, you know, as it is recorded, to 1947, the 90 years of saga. This you can get it from the internet, download and see what all happened, from Mangal Pandey to Gandhiji getting us independence, what all happened, who sacrificed, what were the different dimensions of our freedom struggle, which you are aware. But pertaining to the freedom struggle, I would only like to put a question in front of you. Was it just that what we read in the history, so-called peaceful independence movement, or was something more than that? This is one dimension possibly we all have to think about. Some of them who sacrificed, some of them who laid down their lives, even after 70 years, they're referred to as, you know, revolutionaries. They're referred to as people who resorted to arms. Do they deserve this kind of a disrespect, or is it the time we equate them along with other so-called freedom, people who fought for freedom? So this question keeps bothering me, because as he introduced me, you know, I was an army officer. So when I look at, possibly as a youngster, who motivated me? It was Chandrasekhar Azad. It was Khudiram Bose. It was Bhagat Singh. It was Sukhdev Rajguru. It was Chapekar brothers. It was Vasudev Padke. It was Veer Savarkar, one and the only freedom fighter who was sentenced for twice his life time in Andaman. When I say this, I don't discount or the disrespect or disregard the contributions made by others. When Revered Gandhiji goes to participate in the roundtable conference, three of these youngsters were under prison, British prison. Bhagat Singh, Sukhdev and Rajguru. Some people go and ask Mr. Gandhiji, you've become so influential, you're going for the roundtable conference in London, so why don't you speak about these youngsters who have taken it upon themselves to fight for the freedom of our nation, maybe in a different way when compared to Gandhiji's struggle for, or his fight for freedom. It was a little different from what Gandhiji sought after. I'm quite disturbed to, you know, read this again and again in the history books or listen to these being referred to. Gandhiji's, why should I speak for them? They have taken a recourse which I don't approve of myself. So I would like to place before you my own questions that is coming up again and again in my minds. After 70 years, when you talk about the freedom movement of a country, have we really done justice to people who really sacrificed? This one academic question, if you permit me to say, has to be answered at least after 70 years. The first part of Azadi at 70, I think it is more relevant, more important, besides knowing the historical perspective of our freedom struggle. If you look back today, after 70 years, where are we? I'll make a statement to start the discussion or the talk. Being a politician for the past 10 years, and before that, working with the educational institutions and in an army, it keeps cropping up in my mind again and again. Where are we? Where are we? In less than 70 years, if you permit me to say, we have become a loud talking, impractical, dishonest, corrupt, lazy, and intolerant nation. Shall I repeat that? There can be a lot of positives which I'll discuss later, but looking back, the tryst with destiny on the midnight of 14th August 1947 to what we are today as a nation, as a society, as a community, as Indians, with all the potential that this country is blessed with. If you look back somewhere down the line, if we haven't reached the target that it was set for us in 1947, I get this feeling. After 70 years, somebody has to stand on the ramparts of Red Fort and give a clarion call for Swachh Bharat. Because me and you and all of us cannot keep our neighborhood clean. So when I say we have become a loud talking, impractical, corrupt, lazy, dishonest, and intolerant nation, I refer this statement to the very democratic institutions that we modeled based on what we have in so-called England, who are our rulers. The model called democracy is a political, geopolitical group. Okay, fine. The model called democracy is essentially meant for a very enlightened citizenry. Isn't it? When there is enlightened citizenry, the offshoot is enlightened leadership. When there is enlightened leadership, there will be accountability, there will be responsibility. And when there is accountability and responsibility well defined, there is absolute professionalism. Even though we say we have one of the best written constitutions in the world, in less than 70 years, we have seen 122 amendments. The latest is the GST amendment. I don't say all these amendments were not required. It's a progressive legislation that we have adopted, and amendments are fine. But if our constitution was the most well-written constitution in the world, in most democratic countries, they haven't even adopted 15, 20, 25 amendments. But in less than 70 years, why this country has amended our constitution 122 times? No, these two statements, one is the definition of democracy and Azadi at 70. If you look at this from the political perspective, and if I ask you a question now, how many of you would like to join politics? with great difficulty. Not very certain, not very sure. Because young and bright like you don't come and take a politics seriously, people like us get into politics. I'll ask you another question. What is the average feeling of a politician among the, you know, so-called intellectuals or educated? What is it? How do you look at him? Basically a duffer who cannot articulate, who cannot access technology, who is corrupt, who is dishonest, who keeps promising, right? This is the, isn't it the right kind of feeling, if I can express, among the people? Yes or no? If you look at the voting pattern of this country, with the due apologies, with great difficulty, I could register about 1,800 voters in Manipal during my election. The teachers and graduates living in this place, not less than 3,500 according to me, are in the campus itself, but I could register only about 1,800. You know, how many of them came and cast their votes on that day? Just make a guess. Not even 10%. How many so-called educated people go and exercise their franchise on the election day, whether it is general election or even other elections? Now, Azadi at 70, when we talk of freedom, when we talk of Swatantrata, we should look at it from a different perspective altogether, I feel. I personally feel when you talk of freedom, when you talk of Swatantra, it is basically our responsibility. Now, unless the citizens of this country who have adopted this constitution, we the people of India, that's how it starts, isn't it? If we do not become responsible to ourselves, if we don't become accountable to ourselves, if we don't become answerable to the actions taken by the communities, I don't think a very well-written constitution alone can deliver. We have the largest population living below poverty line in the world. We have the largest population who are illiterates after 70 years in the world today. We're also the people who could send a mom to Mars, possibly at one of the most less expensive way. Between these two, at Azadi at 70, we have a big challenge today. We have adopted a federal structure as per the constitution, where the state has definite responsibility and the center has definite responsibility. We have three very important organs as per the constitution: the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary. Of late, especially after the 71 war, when Madam Indira Gandhi became the most, you know, powerful leader of our country, often we have been seeing trespassing of our role into each other's domain. Legislature poking their nose into the affairs of the executive, legislature poking the nose of poking their nose into the affairs of the judiciary, judiciary becoming overactive and interfering into the matters of legislature, and directing legislature to legislate the way they want it. So there are issues and concerns at Azadi at 70. I get a doubt that we have not understood our responsibilities at all. Last 10 years as a legislator, if you ask me what I have done, except legislation, seriously getting involved in legislation, we're getting involved in all kinds of acts. People come to me for asking for a favor, which according to law is illegal. And you try to explain it to him, as per the law it cannot be done. The standard answer is, that is why we have come to you. If it is as per law, why should I come to you? So somewhere down the line, from top to bottom, we all have misunderstood our role in a system called democracy. So Azadi at 70, or when we look back 70 years of free India, and looking at India becoming one of the, you know, frontrunners in the world scenario, where we all dream of India becoming what Modi ji said, Ek Bharat, Shesh Bharat. We should come together as one so that we can become great. So it all amounts to ultimately defining our own responsibility. Since I'm addressing the academia, basically, in our country, you know how many people graduate from the portals of our various universities on an annual basis? Any rough guess? Rough guess. How many students are there in Manipal campus? According to me, it is not less than 60,000. Manipal put together, not less than 60,000 students. So what could be the number of students passing out annually from within the country? Any wild guess? Madam, it is 1 crore 20 lakh graduates passing out every year. In Karnataka alone, we have 1 crore 40 lakh students from KG to PG. There are more than 5 lakh teachers in Karnataka alone. And how many of them get employment? Make a wild guess. Not even 10%. I am trying to raise this issue because during election, the newspaper people make a survey, isn't it, sir? One of the biggest problems facing our country, according to those surveys, one of the problems is unemployment, yes? Isn't it? I have a background having worked in the industry. There's a place called Baikampadi in industrial area. Baikampadi industrial area, outskirts of Mangalore. Once in a while, we have meetings with the Small Scale Industries Association and people like MSME and all those people. I ask them, what is your problem? Besides government, besides red tapism, besides bureaucracy, corruption and all those things, one of the major problems they always raise is, sir, we don't get people with proper skills. You go to a hotel industry, catering industry, you go to your Valley View, which is a hotel, Valley View, you go and ask them, what is the attrition rate among the employees employed by the hotel, and what is their problem? They'll say, we have good business, but we're not getting right kind of people who can take up employment which is available. Now, after 70 years, even though country has made a progress in almost all areas, we have a major problem about unemployment. You go to rural sector, go to villages. He talked about my village from Karkala Taluk. We don't grow paddy. First crop of paddy, we just don't grow. Why? Because farm labor is not available. And the kind of terrain that we have, we cannot mechanize so easily. You go to hotel industry, you go to farming sector, you go to industrial area, or you go and talk to Professor Ballal and ask him, what is your major problem? He says, quality teachers. You go to schools and colleges, like I'm part of NITI Education Trust. We have about 25,000 students with us. Our biggest problem today is not non-availability of students who can come and pay their fees. Our biggest problem is quality teachers. After 70 years of free India, Azadi at 70, that's why I said we're not. Become practical people. There are more than 18 lakh engineering seats available in the country. More than 18 lakh seats. And during last year's admission, Professor Arvind, 8.5 lakh seats were not filled. And among the balance 9 to 10 lakh students who passed out. Not my words. Professor Narayan Murthy says not even 10 to 15% are employable. You get a good, want a good plumber, you don't get a good plumber. You want a good carpenter, you don't get a good carpenter. You want a good mason, you don't get a good mason. And people who do this work day in and day out, somebody who repairs your watches, somebody who repairs your mixer and grinder, somebody who repairs your television, somebody who repairs your mobile, somebody who does all these technically skilled work, they don't have any certificate. They have not undergone IT, they have not undergone diploma, they have not undergone engineering course. So, Azadi at 70, I think we should focus on becoming a practical nation. Azadi at 70 should make us become responsible to ourselves. Can I ask a delicate question to you? There is a test tomorrow. And Professor Nandakishore enters the classroom and gives a question paper. Can he walk out without invigilation? Do you have invigilation during exams? Huh? Yes or no? Touch your heart and tell me. Have we become accountable to ourselves that you give me the question paper and I'll write what I know? I'll not copy. Is it possible? Is it possible or should it happen or not? I used to jovially tell people the biggest problem or biggest tension the students undergo just before the exam is not something which bothers, is not the question paper that they're going to get after 10 minutes. What bothers them is who is going to be the invigilator in my classroom today. Correct, na? Yes or no? Damn it, if I have joined this institution to learn, and if I'm a responsible student, if I've come here seriously for learning, why there should be issues about attendance shortage? I have paid for this education and I have come here to learn. Why there should be restrictions, regulations about attendance? Why I should be bothered who is going to come and invigilate as long as I am responsible to myself? I'm just giving a very simple example to make you understand how irresponsible state we have become altogether. There was a boy who came to me, he was around 19, 20 years of age. I was not a legislator those days, I was still working with NITI Education Trust, but I had good rapport with the police, local police. He came to me, sir, I am told, you know, the SP, those days SP could appoint the police. There was no centralized kind of a recruitment. And somebody had referred him to me. I'm a crazy guy, whoever comes to me, the first question I ask is, will you join army? He said, sir, army is good, you know, all those things are fine, but I want to join police. After 5-10 minutes of discussion, I ultimately told him, okay, you have been so forceful, you have been pressurizing me, I'll talk to the SP, but tell me the truth. Why is that you don't want to join army? They also wear uniform and more respectable job. What is so special about the police? You know what is the answer he gave me? At 19 he says, sir, in army there is no extra income. In army there is no extra income. You have reserved your smile or laughter, but possibly wanted to smile. Maybe in front of Professor Arvind and Nandakishore, don't want to become very, you know, kind of friendly and free. But what bothered me, at 19, that is the age you are inspired from within. That is the age where you are driven by values. That is the age you dream big. That is the way you challenge the establishment. That is the time when you challenge all the wrongs and ills in society. And at that age, he has compromised already. When I go and talk to young school children, 9th, 10th, and you know, that age, you also should answer this question if I ask this. Why do you go to schools and colleges? Why? That's a very, very dangerous statement. Okay, no, I understand. When I ask this question to somebody who is doing post-graduation, it's a very responsible answer you're supposed to give. But if you go to a high school child and ask him, why do you go to school? The first thing they say, Kannadadalli heltare, kalilike, to learn. Without blinking an eyelid, majority of the students will say, shalage yakke hogudu, kalilike. I'm sorry if somebody don't understand Kannada. I said, initially I took your permission. Next question. Yen kalilike? What is that you want to learn? They take a little time to understand what is that we want to learn. What is that we want to learn? Damn it, don't tell me. You all are PG students, no? Huh? And if I ask this simple question, why do you come to a postgraduate department or a TAPMI? You take 30 seconds, a minute to find out the answer. Then what is that you want to learn? And at the end of the day, you may not answer me. What is that you want to learn? The children will say, Vidya. Vidya, we want to learn Vidya. What is that you want to learn? Huh? Yeah, this is a very important dimension of education, which is completely lost out. How to learn, we don't know. And what to learn, we don't know. Why we should be learning, what we are learning, that we don't know. Now, third question I ask, yaake shalege hogudu vidya kalilike? Why you want to learn? You know, they'll try to give answers, and in most cases, at the end of the day, they end up answering a good job. Correct? And they try to ask them, how do you define a good job? Something which gives you a handful of salary, social status, material comforts in life. Is anything wrong with it? Nothing wrong with that. We all should aspire for that. But Azadi at 70, there is an important link we are missing. Maybe, see, when some youngsters went to Vivekanandaji, Vikram Swamiji, when he returned from his 4 years of wonderful world tour, that 1893, World Parliament of Religions, Brothers and Sisters of America, those five words, they mesmerized the world. You know, he became an instant hit in today's parlance, if I try to explain. So when he returned after 4 years of his world tour and comes back to India, some youngsters go to him. Vivekananda Swamiji had his own views on independence, but he did not take part in the independence struggle. Have you read anything about it anywhere? No, no, he's not involved. So these youngsters, when they went to him, they asked him a question. Swamiji, you are so profound. With one lecture in the World Parliament of Religions, you could mesmerize the entire world, and you made the entire world sit up and listen to you. So you're so profound, you're so powerful, you're so influential, why not get us independence? Swamiji was silent for a little while. Then he asked a question, what next? What next? What next after completing your, is it MBA or?
Master's program.
Master's program in? MBA only. So, MA in political science, okay. So what next after political science, MA? Does it bother you? Be frank. Huh? Does it bother you? So when these youngsters asked the question to Swami Vivekananda, he was silent for a few seconds. He asked the same question, what next? Now it was a turn to get puzzled, the youngsters who went to ask him this question. They said, what next? You're all fighting for independence, you get independence. He says, what next? And they did not have any answer. That is the time he made a statement, we need men of character in this world, in this country. And he said, when we have men of character, your independence is incidental. It will happen just like that. So after 70 years of Azadi or Free India, I think in most important positions, we have failed to send men of character. If there is a police in Tiger Circle, your helmet will be on the, isn't it? If the police is not there, after 15 or 18 years of formal education, when you come out, number one, we don't have single skills on our fingertip. We don't become an authority, an expert in any chosen area. Because we go to classes because there is attendance. We attend exams because we need a certificate. We don't mind copying and getting marks because somebody is looking at our marks. If you change the perspective, I'm referring to this, please don't get hurt if I'm when I say this. Try to lead to other issues also. If I have been a very serious student myself, if I come here to learn, and if I have accessed skill in those 3 years, 4 years, 2 years, whatever time you spend in the colleges, try to access as much as possible and become self-confident and self-reliant, marks will be, happening automatically. You know, your being good student would have earned you better accolades. You would have earned your marks. You would have earned your degree. You would have earned your ranks or whatever it is, distinction or whatever it is. But since we are not responsible to ourselves, since we are not accountable to ourselves, we end up doing a lot of negative things. Because we are not defined our own requirements. So why I'm trying to say this is, Azadi at 70, unless this 1.2 billion plus people of this country become responsible to ourselves, only, is it a municipality or a, Manipal is what, a panchayat? It's still a panchayat. Manipal panchayat cannot come and clean the entire city. Without we becoming responsible to ourselves and as citizens of this particular township, if you don't take care of yourself, putting the blame on the local panchayat, putting the blame on somebody who is a local elected member, I don't think we can find solutions. We have a civil engineering department in the engineering college neighborhood. Don't we have a civil engineering department here? Now tell me, frankly, touch your heart and tell me. This question bothers me. Do you think our civil engineers know how to make good roads? If I question this in an open forum where there are civil engineers, I may be hurting their conscience. But when you drive around, when you go around, Nandakishore introduced me as somebody who has gone around the world. There are places where we get more rains than South Canara or Udupi. There are places that countries, those countries are much more poorer than our country. But they have better roads. They have better amenities. Why not in our country? And after all, who are these people who have been cheating us, who have been taking us for a ride? Are they from the rural area who are made of one as thumbprints? Are they not the people who are educated? Are they not the people who have accessed education? Are they not the people who accessed education and through that got into these important roles in society? Are they not the people who went through the process of education and got into various elected positions in the country? So Azadi at 70 is, are we a responsible citizenry? That is what I said. In less than 70 years, we have become a loud-talking, impractical. I did not use the word irresponsible, a little negative. Now, this is the situation the country is facing. I heard that 65-minute speech of Honorable Prime Minister on the 15th of 2014 from the ramparts of Red Fort. And this year's speech also, I heard it is a little longer than that. What touched me most He used two sentences in Hindi. 68 साल के बाद देश का जो मानसिकता है ऐसा बना है कि हर एक आदमी यही सोचता है इसमें मुझे क्या है, व्हाट इज देयर इन इट फॉर मी. अगर इससे थोड़ा सा हट के अलग से सोचना शुरू करेंगे हम, इसमें मेरा क्या है, व्हाट इज माय रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी इन दिस, दीज टू सेंटेंसेस विल चेंज द एंटायर आउटलुक ऑफ द कंट्री एंड वी विल बी what we want to be in next 15, 20 years. Azadi at 70 is becoming a responsible citizenry, becoming a responsible individual. After this formal education, since I'm talking to students of a postgraduate institute, let's ask questions to ourselves. If we have been socially responsible, if that consciousness of being socially responsible citizenry is alive within us, you think Nirbhaya case would have happened in Delhi? Should it happen? Or something which happened in Manipal few years ago? So these are the questions that is facing our country today. Country has immense potential. Indians, wherever they have gone abroad, whichever country, I would say they are one of the most loved citizen, part of the citizenry there. They are the best workforce, the best doctors in America, the best engineers in America, the best scientists working in NASA. You all have the statistics, you know, you get these messages in the WhatsApp. They happen to be from our country. You go to Gulf, from the low-end jobs to the top-end jobs, they are the best workforce in the Gulf. They have immensely contributed to the might of the Arab world. What happens to us when are within the country? If there is one organization in the entire country which is respected even today, it is the armed forces. Yes or no? You still respect a lot because of the sacrifice they make. I've served in the army. I look at the entire nation and I ask these questions to myself. They come from the same socio-economic background. They come from the same village background. They come from very poor and caste-ridden society. But why are they different? How are they different? What happens to them in the small one-year training period? How do they change themselves? I am representing the teachers in the council. So people come to me, that is happening in Udupi district now. In fact, I have a lot of calls coming. The government schools do not have the number of students, you know, as it used to be 50 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago. So numbers have come down. So there are excess teachers in that school. So these teachers are being transferred to the neighboring school where there is a requirement. Maybe somebody is retired, maybe somebody has left the job, or whatever it is. From Kundapur Taluk to Udupi, if somebody is transferred because there is no work in that school, they don't tolerate that. How can I move from Kundapur to Udupi? Whereas I have seen soldiers who get married. Next morning they are asked to come and report at the unit. Without complaining, they come and stay. Without even demanding that I am just married, please permit me 1 month's leave, they come back and report. Same people. If Indian armed forces can function without reservation policy, if Indian Army can function by defining merit as they want it and recruit people based only on merit, if Indian Army can insist on rule of law, three things. Azadi at 70 years will be realized. A society which has continuously overlooked merit, a society which has compromised on mediocrity in the name of so many things. Now tell me, can we dream of excellence in any walks of life? Azadi at 70 should redefine our priorities. In next 20 years, if I want to be in certain place, if I want certain number of goals in Olympics, don't you think the preparation should start now? So Azadi at 70 is that preparation as a nation we should be planning. You simply cannot, you know, put the blame on a system without being responsible yourself, saying that this politics is very bad in this country. Every politician is bad in this country. The executive doesn't function. Every system is collapsed completely. So unless I change myself, this is what Gandhiji said, the change that we want to see in the world should start from within. So when I change, the immediate neighborhood around me changes. So can we become the change agents? Can we become responsible to ourselves? So Azadi at 70 should remind us that the Azadi that me and you are enjoying today did not come free of cost. There was a person called Karnar Sadashura from the neighborhood town called Mulki. He was a man born with a silver spoon. His entire property got completely decimated during the freedom struggle. Everything was laid at the service of nation. And as a grateful country, when he died, the family did not have funds to cremate him. People had to go around collecting chanda and then cremate, just from Mulki. So there are people like Karnar Sadashiva in lakhs. When Lal Bahadur Shastri gave a clarion call during the India-China war, my dear fellow countrymen, country is in dire straits. Can you add to the might of the country by observing fast on every Monday night? There are people who are fasting even today, influenced by his clarion call. There are people who took out everything that they were wearing in gold ornaments. They donated to the world's nation's requirement. Now, this kind of a responsibility, if we don't look at it from that perspective, I'm a student, I've come here, I will contribute to the might of this nation by becoming a good student, a responsible student. I'm a faculty here. I'm teaching my students. In their young faces, I look at them as somebody who's going to become a legislator, somebody who's going to hold very important positions in the government, somebody who's going to don the role of an executive, or whatever it is. So I'm going to give my might to the students so that we build a very strong nation. So this, I personally feel, Azadi at 70 is basically becoming responsible to ourselves. Swatantrata is not Swachantrata. Yes or no? Freedom is misinterpreted. People can come to Bangalore, conduct a program, and then talk against nation. And talking against nation, they can shout against the valor and the sacrifice of the army, armed forces. And that is defined as freedom. I don't think that is the right definition of freedom. The Swatantrata, the freedom of expression, the right of expression. What is it called? Freedom of expression. Freedom of speech. What some people are claiming in this country today as freedom of speech or freedom of expression came because of the sacrifices made. Made by thousands and thousands of people, which gave us a constitution. That constitution gave us the freedom or expression or right of speech or whatever it is. And today they are forgetting the very sacrifices made by those people who gave us this freedom. And I personally feel AZADI AT 70 is that responsibility. Our land cannot be used for the subversive activities. A soldier from Tamil Nadu or Kerala or Karnataka, if he thinks like those people, I don't think he will lay down his life in the borders of Kashmir. Why should he lay down his life for the people of this country? Doesn't he have human rights? Why should be beaten by the so-called separatists in Kashmir Valley? He has his family, he has his land, he has his business, he has his life, everything in some other place. Why should he go and die in front of those separatists in Kashmir Valley? So freedom, according to me, is being responsible to those people also who are safeguarding our interests, who are laying down their lives for me and you to have our comfortable life. Freedom is becoming responsible to them. Freedom is gratefully remembering the sacrifices made by those people. Freedom is becoming responsible in whatever position we see ourselves after 5 years, after 10 years. So that 18 to 20% of people in your age group who are blessed with an opportunity to pursue their education in universities, it is not even 20%, becoming responsible to those 80% of your age who unfortunately cannot access higher education. So tomorrow when I become responsible to myself, I should also remember about those 80% people whose hard work has ensured that the institutions are built in this country where we can pursue our education. This is what I feel about AZADI AT 70, and let me thank Nandkishore profusely, because he called me, and Professor Arvind for having given me this wonderful opportunity to be amongst you on the eve of 70th Independence Day. If there is anything you would like to ask me, I'm available for another 5-10 minutes. Thank you very much.
Department of Labor, and we have started teaching program in